May I have a motion, please?
So moved. Second.
Thank you. Roll call, please, Mr. Keys.
Dr. Corlea.
Here.
Mr. Graff.
Here.
Mr. Johnson.
Here.
Dr. Kane.
Here.
Dr. Modri.
Here.
Mr. Morella. Mrs. Novi. Mr. O'Brien.
Here.
Mr. Palmer.
Here.
Leanna Meir. And Jonathan Kraft. Form present.
Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Keys, please read the New Jersey Open Public Meeting Law Statement.
The New Jersey Open Public Meeting Law is enacted to ensure the right of the public to have advance notice and to attend meetings of public bodies in which any business affecting their interests is discussed or acted upon. In accordance with provisions of the Act, Montville Township Board of Education approved this meeting. Notice of the meeting has been posted at the Montville Municipal Building, Montville Public Schools, Montville Public Library, Montville Township Board of Education Administrative Office Building, Montville Public School website, and advertised in the Daily Record.
Thank you. We will move right into the superintendent's report.
I just wanted to note that our next meeting, March 7th, is when the board is scheduled to receive their training on board docs. And that is about an hour-long training, so that will take place between 7 and 8 o'clock. So we will delay the start of the public portion of the meeting until 8 o'clock that evening. And we will get that word out. It's already been updated on the calendar on the website, and we'll make sure that we send out a notice to everyone.
Just the board docs is the paperless?
Paperless meeting system that will save lots of trees and hopefully make our functioning a little bit more streamlined than the board meetings.
Initially, it might be a little learning curve.
Well, we're going to start. We'll start at the 7th meeting.
And closed session? Will we have a microphone?
If we have a closed session, we will do that at the end of the meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, and one of the things that I'd like to do tonight is to and share the responsibilities with Mr. Tevis is to do a preliminary budget presentation. In terms of our proposed new initiatives, unfortunately, we are not yet in receipt of our state aid allocations for the 2017-18 school year. Sorry, I should have updated that here in the PowerPoint. We're expecting that the governor will have his budget address next Tuesday, February 28th, and then they are obligated to provide us that state aid information by March 2nd. So once we receive that, we're hoping that we should have that information and that we'll be in a hold harmless position, if not perhaps getting a little bit more state aid, but certainly hoping not to have a reduction in our state aid. Once we have that, we'll be able to finalize the revenue section of the budget and compare that with our proposed expenses. So the proposals and the initiatives that we're talking about tonight are kind of promulgated based on the assumption that we will be receiving approximately the same amount of state aid next year. If not, we will have to go back and have some conversations about some of the things that we're talking about tonight in terms of new initiatives. At the elementary school level, we are looking to hire 2 full-time Spanish teachers to provide world language instruction at the elementary grades. This is flowing from the World Language Task Force and their recommendations that we've kind of been building upon what we've done year after year. Last year we addressed expanding the program at the middle school level, so we're looking to now take that down into the elementary level next year. At the middle school, we are looking to upgrade video production equipment. As you know, the Lazar News Network is a very integral part of what goes on at Lazar. It's factored into the cycle classes, and the equipment that we have there is really in pretty good need of upgrading. So we have included that in the budget proposal. At the high school, we are looking to implement several new courses. We also, coming out of the World Language Task Force this year, had developed some upper-level advanced culture classes that will provide sort of an alternative for those students who want to continue to study world language but not necessarily pursue the AP track. So this will allow them to continue past 2 years that are required as part of high school graduation requirements in a little bit different vein, you know, developing their language skills but kind of focused on the culture. We will offer those courses in French, Italian, and Spanish. We are also looking to implement AP Computer Science principles and principles of anatomy. In terms of special services, our enrollment in the integrated preschool class has continued to grow. We currently have two sections of that. At Valley View, we are looking to implement a third section, and that would also be located at Valley View School. We're looking to purchase some speech testing kits and some other child study materials that have been requested by the Special Services Department. In terms of technology, we are looking to implement a one-to-one Chromebook initiative at the high school, which would mean that every child at the high school would have a Chromebook to utilize. This is something that we feel would greatly enhance the way we're able to deliver the curriculum. Currently, not every class has Chromebooks available, so we see this as really kind of moving in the direction of solidifying the technology use at the high school. We've also been talking about the smart board replacement. Austin Thompson, our Director of Technology, has been working to pilot some devices to replace the smart board. We want to get something that is can meet our needs in terms of its versatility and its the way teachers can use it in the classroom, so we'll be looking to do that. We're also looking to acquire a generator for the ITS department. I think, you know, considering everything that we have invested, we want to make sure that, you know, we have a generator there. And with the increase in the number of devices, we are recommending that we add a position in the technology department, a junior systems administrator. We can't multiply the number of devices that we're going to have in use and not provide adequate support for those devices. In terms of the athletic proposals, we have a couple of smaller items, full vault mats and tennis court nets, and then we are recommending that we move forward with the weight room project. We had discussed that in the Mustangs that come several meetings ago. That involves removing the wall between the spin and the weight rooms and then installation of rubberized floor in the weight rooms. So that is, I believe, somewhere in the neighborhood of $40,000 to $50,000 for that project, and we are looking to incorporate that. In terms of curriculum development, we are moving ahead with implementing the next generation science standards. The Department of Education calls for us to implement those standards in grades K to 5 during the next school year. So in doing that, we need to make sure that we purchase the necessary textbooks and materials that are aligned to those standards so that the teachers can deliver that curriculum. In terms of our budgetary constraints, I'm going to hand things over to Mr. Tevis and let him walk us through that.
Yeah, at this time, this is obviously still preliminary, because we are waiting, as Dr. Votar mentioned, for our state aid numbers, and hopefully we'll have those within the next week or so. But preliminarily, we're looking at a budget that, like any other budget, like any other school district budget, is comprised predominantly of salaries and health benefits. And they constitute somewhere around 75-76% of the entire budget. You know, on average, our salaries increased 2.5% for the current year that we're in, 2016-2017. And on average, they're going to increase 2.4% for the 17-18 school year. Health benefit premiums are estimated to increase by 6%. You know, it stands to reason, therefore, that the potential to introduce new programs or expand existing ones is very restricted. You know, given that such a substantial portion of our budget, you know, 76%, is above our local increase for local tax levy of 2% that we're capped at. So it is becoming increasingly difficult to install these new initiatives that Dr. Rockstar has suggested. That being said, let's go to that slide. Again, the statements I'm making here are definitely assuming that we are going to be held harmless on our state aid for the 17-18 school year. Well, assuming that that is true, we would certainly be looking to limit our local tax levy increase to, you know, within the 2% cap, and only go above the 2% cap. This board has been very good about maintaining that since it was instituted. It was changed back there to November, was taken away, where it hasn't once gone through that 2% local tax levy increase. We're looking to keep the expense budget less than 1%. Last year it came in somewhere around 0.76%. Right now, we're right around the same area, certainly would be less than 1%. And the budget, as again, assuming state aid, is all harmless, so we would look to introduce some of these new education facility initiatives that Dr. Rockstar has done. Want to take some of the capital? Some of the facility and maintenance initiatives that we are looking to put forth for the 17-18 proposal to the board is over at the Hilldale School. We're looking to reconfigure the media center. Provide two small group instruction areas over at the Hilldale Media Center. This is actually a project that the board has already approved and added it to the 17-18 budget. This was a result of a direct outcome from the Demographics Task Force recently made decisions. At the William Mason School, we're looking to reconfigure the drop-off area at that building to increase safety. And anybody that's been there at dismissal time and in the morning when the buses are dropping off knows that this is a very worthwhile project and one that's, for safety reasons, really needs to be done. It's going to be a big bonus to that school. We have capital facility maintenance initiatives that we're looking to propose for part of the September 26, 2017 referendum vote that the board voted to move forward with a meeting or so ago. The referendum is going to be broken into three specific questions, and it's going to be a district-wide facility improvements. Predominantly, we're going to be doing roof replacements, HVAC controls, restroom renovations, and renovations to each of the media centers in all seven of the schools, obviously, except the high school for the media center. And that will be part of the first or main referendum question, question number one. Second question will be put forth for gymnasium renovations. And again, that will be at every building. And the third question on air conditioning. What's important to point out here is that the second two questions, question number two and question number three, will only pass if question number one is passed by the board. So that's an important point that we're trying to drive home. So one of the things, you know, when we're actually putting together our capital side of the budget for 17-18, it's going to be much lighter than it has been in previous years. This board has been very consistent ever since I was retained as the business administrator in keeping about $1 million budgeted in their capital facilities area. For the maintenance and ongoing maintenance of the buildings, it's very important. Because now we're going to be doing a referendum, we're going to be addressing many of these maintenance issues up front. We're not going to have that need, at least for the foreseeable next few years, to budget that same $1 million. So we're going to be using that, obviously, to help offset on the general fund tax side. Excuse me. Again, the district is compiling a direct budget, which is based on the assumption that the state aid we receive from the Department of Ed is going to remain flat in the 17-18 school year. And I believe, as Dr. Rothar mentioned, we're not looking to get those state aid figures until March 2nd. And do you want me to address the time limit?
I can through, take a harder look at some of the things that we've incorporated into the budget. As we've talked about with regard to the demographic study and some of the other conversations that we've had, the district is in a declining enrollment situation, and the forecast that was included in the demographic study that was performed last spring indicates that we should be experiencing a decline over 5 years of the study, and then perhaps for an additional several years after the period of the study. So while the demographic study examined the impact of declining enrollment, and we talked about our ability to continue to maintain comprehensive programs at the middle and high school, and we believe that we'll be able to do that for the foreseeable future, one of the things that we did talk about the task force was taking a close look at the class size policy and trying to maintain our class sizes within those policy parameters. So as you might expect, when you do the math, if you have fewer students, chances are over time you're going to experience some decline in the number of classroom teachers that you have. So we are closely analyzing our staffing needs for the 2017-18 school year, but due to the effect of those enrollments and adhering to class size, it's quite possible that we may see the elimination of some teaching positions, but still maintaining class size within the policy limits. So where we go from here, at the board's next meeting on March 7th, to comply with the budget timelines, we will need to adopt a tentative budget to submit to the executive county superintendent. So we will have Mr. Tevis calculating fast and furious once we get the state aid numbers to put the final touches on the budget. We will continue to discuss the budget at the following meetings in March and April. And then May 2nd, assuming that the budget has been approved by the county superintendent, we will have a public hearing on the budget, and the board will ultimately adopt a final budget for the 2017-18 school year. And that's it. So I don't know if any of the board members have any questions.
Mr. Brown. Can you just go back one slide? Please.
Yes.
March 7th, I mean, it doesn't give a lot of time. You're getting the state aid on Thursday, the 2nd. To turn around, is March 7th the last date we can submit the tentative budget?
The last date for submission is March 20th.
It's March 20th?
Yes.
Yes.
So
the county would accept March 21st.
They have told us they will not.
They will not. They can't.
They told us specifically they will not.
I'm just thinking, might it be prudent to give you guys some breathing room to change the 7th and 14th leave? Because you're going to get the state aid. What happens if it's not as much as we anticipated? It's going to involve reducing or making changes in line items. And I'm just wondering if changing the date to the 14th might give you some breathing room. We would still make it, and this just be for, I mean, just an idea that we're assuming it's all going to be flat. If it isn't, it could mean if we're short, whatever, might involve taking money from other items, redistributing. And if we get them on Thursday, you send it back to us on Friday. Doesn't give you guys much time to make changes. And that's only if we don't have to decide. I mean, I guess we do. We meet here, we don't meet here in February, right?
You're
I mean, you could leave the 7th meeting also.
Well, we need the 7th meeting.
And just make the 14th as to adopt the tentative budget. That might be better. I don't know.
I don't think Jim would object to
that. I would not object to that at all. I think that's a great idea.
But we do need to have, even if we come come strictly just for the board docs training, because those dates are locked in at this point, and those I can't change.
So we get up a...
But to move the meeting, the regular meeting, and have the...
I don't care to move the regular one, or you want to have another one, it's just...
Just for the specific purpose of adopting the budget.
Exactly, yeah.
The 7th, just either the budget and the docs?
No, the 7th will be a regular board meeting and board docs, and then the...
Or it could just be board docs.
How about this? On the 7th, we'll have a meeting where the only items on the agenda will be the board docs and adopting the tentative budget.
Well, no, that's what we're trying to have additional time for Jim to work on the budget, so move the budget adoption for submission to the 14th.
Okay, you don't have to, okay. So nothing has to be done on the 7th?
No.
Gotcha, okay, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Misinterpreted.
I'm fine with that. Would we have a forum?
Just give you some more...
Would we have a forum of people on the 14th?
I'd rather take the extra couple days and go through it rather than have to come back with changes. It's a lot of pressure in an 8-hour timeframe.
That would be appreciated.
You know?
So you would be talking about having a public meeting on the 14th? Would we have executive session? No need?
I would say no need.
So we could start at 7:30?
Sure.
Would that be possible?
Yes.
All right, would we have a forum? Would everyone be able to attend that meeting on the 14th?
One second.
I don't know.
March 14th.
March 14th.
Well, we wouldn't have executive session on the 14th?
Mike, you can.
Thank you. We wouldn't, well, let me just ask.
We would not have executive session.
We're not having executive session on the 7th either.
We could have executive session on the 7th. It would not be at 7:00. It would be after the meeting.
We have the regular session meeting after the 1-hour training, the public session at 8:00, and then closed session if we need to afterwards.
And then we also have a meeting on the 21st?
That's the question.
We could probably not have a meeting on the 21st. Is that meeting on the 21st a regular board meeting? Yeah, it is. So we might need... Well, it depends if you can get your bill list together for the 14th. Okay, then we could swap the 14th for the 21st.
So we could change the 21st to the 14th?
Yeah.
It's a lot of work. I know several of you are involved in that, but it's not just push a button.
So, I mean, while we think about this, Renee, the budget, this preliminary budget that you presented, the initiatives are predicated on flat state aid.
Yes.
So if the aid comes in short of that, you know, we've never used bank cap. Is that an option?
It's something that...
Is there any bank cap we're going to lose this year if we don't use it?
Well, we lose there's always bank cap.
It's certainly an option. It would pump up the tax levy.
Yeah.
I think you'd use bank cap and go to referendum and see if 2%
is bad.
Really, it's not a good move. That's
right. But now with the referendum. I thought the bank cap, I thought you'd keep bank cap for 2 to 3 years.
We've never used it. We accumulate bank cap every year. And so some of it falls off the table, and then new eligibility comes off the table. So,
right, but isn't bank cap only the amount that we don't use between what our percentage is and up to 2%? So we've been...
No, not necessarily. It's the spending growth limitation adjustments that we are eligible for that we don't use as well.
That's true. That's right. In addition to percentage. Okay. It's 3 years.
No, I know it goes back 3 years. But my understanding is it would be the difference between what the actual tax levy is versus... up to the 2%, the difference.
Do you know how much bank cap we have this year if we have to use it?
I have to go back and I'm not that far yet in the budget process.
Matt, I've added this quote on the confusion when we just look at the way it is.
I think moving the meeting to the 14th is a good thing.
Okay. You feel that way, too?
Yes.
All right. So the feeling is then we will have our regular meeting with board docs for the first hour, 7:00, 8:00 on the 7th. An open session meeting at 8 p.m. on the 7th, and then close our executive session afterwards if we so need it.
7:45.
No, on the 7th, we would meet from at 7 o'clock for our board docs training, which will take an hour. And then open session will begin at 8 o'clock.
Good idea.
Okay.
And then close session after the open.
Close session after.
If we need it.
There's a realistic chance we won't. Then on the 14th, we're talking a public session at 7:30. So everyone knows. Just this one item, and no executive session. And then we would likely be substituting the meeting on the 14th and swapping out the meeting on the 21st. Is that correct?
Yeah, I can certainly add the bills list on the 21st.
Well, so if we're doing away with the meeting on the 21st, then the agenda for the 14th will not just be a one item agenda. It will be, a more full agenda.
But we could
still start.
Okay, then we would go back to meeting our first meeting in March would still be the 7th.
That's correct.
Correct?
Yes.
We resume our normal schedule.
So we'll meet the 7th and the 14th, but not the 21st.
So the 14th, is there an executive session before the meeting or not? The 14th. I mean, if we're not doing the meeting until 7:30, maybe we should advertise for the executive session at 7 just in case.
Seems like we should have.
Okay.
Why don't we leave everything in wait, just slide in the 14th to do the budget? Leave everything as listed here, just like moving in on the 14th to do the budget.
Special.
Whatever you guys want. Okay, we'll be out here every meeting.
I think we can have the administration figure this out and let us know. But we would have a quorum on the 21st.
I wouldn't be down on the 21st.
On the 14th. You would not be here. You're retired. Right. Okay. So it looks like we would have a quorum.
Okay. Good. All right.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
We'll work at that all out.
All right.
And that's it for me. I'm done.
Are there any other board member questions about the budget? I would like to thank.
There's a question about the referendum, but I could wait till June. That's his referendum.
Jim's going to do what is becoming now, and I'll let you talk about that, Mr. Tevis, a standing report in your business administrator's report on the where we are with respect to the referendum project.
Yeah, as public probably aware at this point, we are moving towards a referendum for September 26th, 2017. It's a special bond referendum for capital facility improvements district-wide. As we mentioned in the PowerPoint presentation a few minutes ago, it's going to be comprised of three questions. Question one has a number of items in it, bathrooms, media center renovations, roof, and one other. Throwing a blank for the second, but then with two additional questions, one for air conditioning and I believe bathroom renovations is the second question. At this point, we're on track for submissions now to the Department of Education. At the last meeting, we passed a resolution authorizing the architect to begin work on the plans and the drawings and to submit to the Department of Education. What this does is, in addition to giving us approval to move forward with the project with the Department of Ed, it also gives us our preliminary eligible cost estimates for debt servicing. And that's a big reason for us moving forward with this entire referendum project was because of the potential for a significant potential of 40% in debt service aid towards the cost of these projects. It's a significant amount of money that's on the table. We probably will be getting those. We look to get those numbers somewhere within 60 days or so after submitting the architect submits down to the department. We know it's a preliminary estimate. We don't get the final eligible cost, or the final estimate, final cost, that is, until the end of the approval process, which will probably be sometime this summer. But we're probably going to start to do road shows and presentations of that sort come late spring, and what we're really waiting for is that preliminary eligible cost from the department. so that we can give the public a better handle on exactly what we're going to get in terms of the debt service aid. So at this point, we are, I spoke with the architect just today, we are on track for a mid-March submission down to the department. The Finance and Facilities Committee is going to need to meet one more time once we finalize the submission with the architect. He's going to come in, he's going to go over with us one last time. I know there were a few outstanding questions that some of the committee members had, so we want to address those as well. I'm sorry, I totally didn't move the side of the table, I apologize. So at this point, as soon as I hear back from the architect in the next couple of weeks, I'm going to call the chair of finance and get us a Finance and Facilities Committee meeting together rather quickly.
So Jim, it's not really so much, well, I do have one question, but I've just heard, in the community a question about the roof. There seems to be some misunderstanding that the roof project is all seven roofs all at once.
Yeah.
So I think as we go forward, we just need to be mindful that not only is it the high school Lazar and William Mason, it's not even all of the high school or all of Lazar, it's those sections that have come due.
That's correct. That's absolutely correct.
So I just think as we go forward, we need to make that clear so there's no misunderstanding. The other concern I heard was the cost of utility costs with air conditioning, and I think you had given us a breakdown some time ago.
Yes, I shared with the committee an analysis on potential utility costs associated with the air conditioning specifically. So I could certainly put that, incorporate that into our next presentation that Dr. Rowe tomorrow will
do. Do you happen to remember what that was?
I don't have the actual cost off the top of my head.
It was $15,000. So just to put it out there, it's really not...
It wasn't a large amount of money.
It was not a large amount of money, and hopefully with the new HVAC controls, we'll be gaining some...
We should. The net should be a net win.
Cost savings.
Yes, that is anticipated.
And just the last thing is, when we talk about the referendum question number two, where it says gymnasium renovations, it's the main gymnasium in the high school?
Yes.
And it's the gymnasium at the middle school?
There's one gym.
Yes, one gym at the middle school,
that's correct.
But in the elementary schools, they're not gymnasiums.
They're all-purpose rooms.
They're multi-purpose rooms. And so I think that's also an important talking point, because these rooms are not just used for athletics. They're used for assemblies.
Cafeteria.
They're used for eating, cafeteria. So they truly are multi-purpose rooms, and I think we should distinguish that. Because it's not sure. Seven gymnasiums we're doing.
That's a great point.
Multi-purpose rooms and two gyms.
And we'll certainly incorporate that into the next presentation that we do.
Thank you.
Any other board member questions or comments? I guess one thing that I would want to say, and your point is well taken about the roofs, Dr. Cordellino, is that we have been methodically and systematically taking care of our roofing needs year over year over year. So that fortunately, we are not in a position where we have to go ahead and make changes to all seven roofs, because we've been very organized in our understanding of what our district needs are. That being the case, are you?
Just one more comment. I'm sorry. Just the last comment I have, and I just realized it. Thank you, administration, for considering the needs of the high school in terms of the weight room. They were an impassioned group that night, and it's nice that we can find room in our budget for that. Hopefully.
See what happens. Any committee reports?
Just Mr. Stevenson indicated that we might be needing a finance report again. Looking at the revised schedule that we just came up with the board meeting date, would March 8th, which is a Wednesday, be logical to have it at that time?
Yes, I believe that would be an optimum date.
Okay, so can you schedule something for more day, 5:15?
Certainly.
Works for me, Jim.
You know, my son is home from college that week. We're booking all these meetings.
Any other committee reports?
Yeah, curriculum, just met before the meeting. We only discussed one item, and the administration will be sending out the minutes in the, probably within the next day or so for the board's consideration.
Thank you. Ad hoc liaisons? PTC liaisons?
Well, Mars Cannon met last week, Mars Cannon School Boards. It was a tri-county meeting conducted through the internet, basically. It was live streamed, three locations, Salem, Union, and Mars County. The topic was First Amendment rights for staff, students, and the public. And other than a few glitches at the beginning of the meeting, it went very well, and people seemed to enjoy it. The next meeting is March 22nd. It's at Fairleigh Dickinson University.
Where, Karen?
At Fairleigh Dickinson. I don't know exactly where, but I know it's in the Madison campus. We're going to have a discussion on changing student enrollment. Other school districts are also experiencing predominantly reductions in enrollment. The pilot program, which is payment in lieu of taxes, this is where municipalities can actually encourage development in their communities and make deals with developers, whether they be housing or commercial, not to pay taxes. Instead, they pay a payment to the municipality, basically cutting out the school district. So even if there are children involved, there are no taxes to be levied by these programs. So by these buildings. So we'll have to talk about that. We're going to talk about some of the Army programs. And the last meeting of the year, April 26th, celebrating Morris County Schools. And there's going to be a presentation on board docs for all of Morris County. And PTC, I did attend Cedarville's PTC meeting, and I spoke to them about the referendum and our infancy of the budget development and also the Narcan policy.
Thank you, Karen. Any other liaisons?
I think we kind of skipped over, kind of breezed through delegate liaisons.
Mm-hmm.
DAC was February 8th, and one of the things that was talked about at some length was a guest who came in and talked about a way to try to indoctrinate the new LEAD program into the schools. LEAD is an acronym for Law Enforcement Against Drugs. It's, I guess, very much akin to the old DARE program with it is, but it isn't, with improvements, and they're going to either have been or will be trying to discuss with the administration ways to indoctrinate this program into the schools and hopefully have it aligned with some of the curriculum.
Thank you, Mr.
Okay. Several months ago, you appointed Mr. O'Brien and myself as liaisons to the 150th anniversary celebration committee. I have not heard one word about any meeting or anything of that nature. I don't know if you have, Mike. I know we're into March. March, April, May, June, 4 months to go. And I'm just wondering if maybe some administrator could contact, or I think you wrote to Deb Nielsen, if there's going to be a meeting, or if there's not, that's okay too. But I want to make sure that Mike and I didn't miss it, because she asked you, we appointed two of us. So, I mean, I'm very, maybe that happened to me, I don't know. But I'm anxious to represent the board, because I think a lot of our facilities are going to be asked to be used, and we know nothing about it, at least I don't. And as the liaison, I also asked if you could add it to the agenda for the next 3-4 months, so we're aware of it as an ad hoc committee. Find out what's happening. So if some administrator, I don't care who it is, can find out from Cannon, Shannon, Nielsen, if there is a meeting, if there isn't, But people have been asking me, I said, I don't know anything about it. That's agreeable.
Thanks, Charlie. Why don't you take that one, please? Thank you.
While I'm there, can I ask just a question? Are within schools and your curriculum, are there going to be some programs related to 150th so far?
There are some things in the works. I think particularly at the high school level, they're working on some projects. But there are other things going on at other grade levels as well.
Thank you.
And David Tubb reported at the last library board meeting that the history department at the high school was doing some projects going back to the beginning of the township. And so when I know, that's what he mentioned.
I did see that from my sense. I just didn't know the extent.
Thank you. I'd like to, any additional reports? I'd like to open the floor for public participation for items on the agenda. Seeing as there is none, we'll close that. And I'd like a motion to accept the recommendations of Superintendent Brighton's eye. So moved.
If we could just make that slight adjustment to Resolution O to reflect that the March 7th meeting, the public session will begin at 8 p.m. rather than 7:45.
Yes, thank you. Yes, that's right there. Yes, I do need to make a revision to K.6, Resolution K.6. The actual professional fee, flat fee cost, there's a typo in that. It's not $45,000, it's $47,000. Thank you, Dr. Norda, for pointing that out. So we just would like to revise that Resolution K.6. To be $47,000 for flat professional fee cost, plus reimbursable expenses at the additional maximum cost not to exceed 2007.
Okay. Any board member comments or questions? Item I. Any board member comments or questions? Item J.
Just a quick comment on J.3. Just to thank you to the board for reviewing and listening to our presentation on the proposed mission and value statements. And thanks to the Grant Committee, Grant Trust, for that hard work and bringing all this together.
You did a great job.
Thanks. Sue is in the back. I have a perfect thanks.
Thank you for your work on that.
You read that just like Sue told
you. Any questions or comments? Item K. Or item L. Questions or comments? Item M. Or N as in Nancy.
Renee, do you, I don't remember, but is the Narcan policy, is there going to be Narcan in all seven schools? Because that was a yes. Yes. Question was that a yes. Okay.
And item O.
Yeah, I know, maybe I'm just not clear on this still. On March 7th at 7 o'clock, we're doing the school docs, right?
Right, so it's public session, not private session at 7 o'clock.
Okay, so there's no closed session. It just should say public session at 7 o'clock.
Right.
Okay.
Roll call, please, Mr. Hughes.
Mr. Brown?
Yep.
Mr. Palmer?
Yes.
Dr. Cordillera?
Yes, except staying on table and check number 8-4627.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Dr. Mudrick?
Yes.
Mr. O'Brien?
Abstain on K1, check number 84555. And no on section N1 policy 5430 and IMO effects.
So noted. And Dr. King?
Yes.
Motion's passed.
Okay, any old business? Do we have a discussion about the school calendar?
We do have discussion about the school calendar.
School calendar for 2018.
2018-19. And I had, provided you with two different iterations of the calendar. One would be not having the teachers come back until after September 1st. The other is to have the teachers come back for those two professional development days at the end of August. That would allow us to bring students back the day following Labor Day. My own personal preference is to adopt that calendar because I do believe that instructional days that occur in September are much more valuable than those that occur in June. But certainly I'm open to discussion. If the board has strong feelings one way or the other in terms of the calendar.
Okay. The question is, if we come back the 30th and 31st of August, right?
The staff.
What happens, our contract theoretically, does it go from September 1 or is it from July 1?
I guess it's theoretically from July 1 because there are things that happen and there have been decisions that have occurred over the past couple years that allow us to.
If some teachers, I know there was a poll taken or something like that, and most teachers didn't mind coming in those 2 days?
The majority.
Majority.
Yes.
Well, what happens if a teacher refuses to come in those 2 days for whatever reason?
They're obligated to work those days.
Pardon?
They are obligated to work
those
days.
Okay, so if they don't, it's an unissued absence, they get docked or whatever it is. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with it.
So am I correct that this has been reviewed with some input from the staff regarding that concept coming in? Am I correct that this has somehow been reviewed with the staff or representatives regarding that issue of forms?
And they were able to voice their preference in a poll. But they did all receive the calendar.
I think it's great to get out earlier in June, which is fantastic.
So just to clarify, if that schedule were to be in effect, then classes would be over the 20th of June.
Graduation, that would be the last day of school, and graduation would occur that evening.
As opposed to the 24th.
Opposed to June 24th, yes.
Assuming we only have 33 snow days.
Well, it does provide 5 snow days, so.
That's 185 day calendar.
Yes.
Any other comments or questions?
We're not voting on this right now.
No.
Just getting
final discussion so that at the next meeting this would appear as a recommendation on the agenda to adopt the calendar.
I don't have a problem.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate your.
Any general board comments?
Just a general question. Potentially, I guess we could be giving back 2 snow days. So I'm looking at the weather between now and early March. I'm not seeing any snow in the forecast. At what point does Dr. Vogtgaard plan on having a discussion as to what days we're going to give back? Any timetable?
I would say probably towards the end of March.
Okay.
Mid to late March. We've had snow as late as April, but by that point we should have a pretty good handle on where we stand.
Okay.
And Matt, just one general comment to all my fellow board members who signed up to participate in the Volleyball Marathon this Friday. I'll send around a note tomorrow. General reminder, meet us in the NTHS gym at 4:45 p.m. and come ready to play.
And bring money.
Donations are welcome.
AG can just donate money.
Thank you. Jim, I just wanted to check, you'll be providing us with budget binders?
This Friday.
This Friday. Very well, thanks. Anyone have any other questions or comments?
Just one question or comment. I see that two of our students are proudly being invited to, two of our original science research students are being honored by being invited to present at the Science Symposium. I'm assuming we will still this year have the original science research symposium.
Our own symposium, yes, it has been scheduled, yeah.
Opening up the floor for public participation. Seeing as there is none, I'd like a motion to adjourn.
So move.